Let's just get started. And in our ministry, we talk about that the person who is presenting, the idea that the presenter is to be a good gift to you. And the best way that that happens is if you're viewing the presenter as a good gift to you, that you open up your heart in praying for the presenter, okay? So if you would, let's just go to the Lord. And if you would, pray for me that I would be a good gift to you. And so, Father, I do. I want to be, you know I do, a good gift of hope, especially in this message, in this day, where people are saying they can't be free, and that anyone who would even communicate that freedom is possible are suspect. And so, Lord, we know that the glorious good news that you have given us through Jesus Christ, the good news, this scandalous good news, transforms lives. Thank you for my transformation. Thank you for grace. And so, Father, may you be glorified in what I share in giving hope. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So a little bit about me. I am the director of a parachurch in Oklahoma City that was actually established 40 years ago during the founding of Exodus. A mom and dad came to the church and basically said our son is struggling with homosexuality, and they got from the church, well, he's an abomination. And at that time, there were a lot of people, as you know, were coming out of different places of following the Lord through the Jesus People movement. And just some things that were happening in the 70s people were deciding that they wanted to live a life free from homosexuality. And as a response to that, there was the formation of what was called Exodus International. But behind the scenes, a lot of people don't understand that it actually took another 5 years before Exodus was really charted with a charter of an understanding that there was a transformational grace. So, you know, you have some of these gay activist people that talk about the founding and that they were a part of the founding. And actually, it's pretty bogus if you understand some of the history, because really it was after in the 80s is when Exodus became more of a solid offering up until, unfortunately, in the early part of 2000 when its directorship changed. And it became unscriptural, unbiblical, unorthodox, and very liberal, and basically teaching antinomianism with a mixture of this orientation thing, so now you can become a gay Christian. So First Home was a part of all of that. I was a part of all of that. And from that, there were statements and things that were done during this last 5-6 years, actually. And it made me think about the lies that were being told and how to counter those lies. And so as a ministry, we have been doing this for 25 years full, or I have been with First Home for 25 years full time. And all that time, we kept records. And we had 1,200 plus people that had filled out information. And so I started a few years ago turning everything that was in paper files and boxes, and we digitalized everything, and we put everything in PDF, and we've saved everything. And then I had staff that took that information and put them in spreadsheets and Excel files. And then we went from that and creating a database. And then from that, we've started contacting people. And in the midst of this, created a survey. And in creating the survey, to just get people to find out what our ministry effectiveness was in these 25 years. So what I'm going to present to you today is this idea that there is freedom. And so this first part is going to actually give you some initial results of the survey findings. So we contacted 1,200 people, or we're in the midst of contacting 1,200 people. We have contacted the people, and I don't know the exact number, but several hundred between the years of 1989 and 99. So we're going to look at those first 10 years today. But I'm happy to report that in the last few days, we sent out 500 emails to the people, the first block from the years 2000 and 2005, somewhere in there. And so those results are already starting to come in. And the percentages that we have to show you today are off maybe by two or three digits one way or another, but they're remaining very consistent even with the new people that are filling out the survey. I'm blessed by one of my supporters who has a Fortune 500 statistician who looked over this survey, and he gave me some pointers on it, and so then we launched it. And he's going to help me with the surveying of the results and drawing up some graphs. And so I'm pretty excited about that. Now, what's going to constitute what is viable in the idea of people change will not be just everybody that passed through our doors or filled out some paperwork. It'll be the people that actually spent at least a year with us. And if they spent a year with us, then we're asking them some really hard questions about where they are. And this is all totally anonymous, and nobody's being coerced. Matter of fact, I'm actually contacting some of the people that had real difficulties with me, with our staff and First Stone, and who even identify themselves as gay, to please take the survey as well. Because I really want to be able to come back with this and say, see, this is what our one little ministry has experienced. And let me tell you, when we look at the data of this, ministry after ministry after ministry in this network, and people that have been doing this work for years and years and years, will be the same type of statistical information if they've offered living waters and deep inner healing prayer and support group and pastoral care as we have. And so it just excites me. And so from this, I'm writing a book, and outside there on the table, you can read more about the project. It's called Freedom Realized. Did I just fade out? Okay, I'm on again, okay. Will be what I'm going to complete this lesson with. So the book is called Freedom Realized. You can read about it also at freedomrealized.org on my blog. So the initial survey results. Let's look at the first chart here. It's pretty exciting. When we surveyed the first block, the percentages that came in from this first 10 years, you can see 10% spent less than 6 months with us. But this higher majority, 17.2, 19.5, the 27.6. So 64% of those that responded were involved with First Stone for at least 1 year. So we go on to the next, and you can see that our disciples, 60% said that it was excellent. I was like, wow, that's really cool. Blew me away. 33.3% said it was good. All right, so you can see these numbers down the column, and we can get into the detail. I don't want to waste as much time on the detail, but what I want to show you is that the effectiveness of those who spent quality time with us actually are rating what we did very high. And I'm telling you, I've actually had some people that have really hated me. Now, some of you that know me, you would probably go, well, yeah, that's you, Stephen. You know, that's kind of the way you are. You're so black and white. People say you're hateful all the time. But look at this. Isn't this great? 93%, 71%, 82%, 53%, 62% are saying we were either excellent or good. Now, that's what you're not hearing about ministries like ours out there. And this is what the people that were involved with us said. Did you consider yourself a Christian? what we describe as a true follower, and there was a statement, it'll be in the book and stuff, but this is just to give you a snapshot, remember that. Not getting into the detail of it, but I wanted to give a hope. 95%, which is not unreasonable for our type of ministry. Matter of fact, high 90%, as you see, we already knew were in a local church most of the time when they come to First Stone. But 20% responded, said they gave their lives to Christ fully as a result of being involved in First Stone. And that just blessed my life. The next one was, did you come to First Stone because you had same-sex attraction? 80% of those that have come through our ministry had same-sex attraction. If your answer to question number 13 was yes, did you consider yourself a homosexual upon coming to First Stone? As you can see, 41% did. 48% said no. The 11 are like moms and dads or what other people coming for other reasons. Another part of this was tracking, and we're tracking actually all kinds of information. This just was to give you a little snapshot of some of the things we're tracking. We're tracking sexual abuse, which actually is lower than I thought. And it may go up a little bit higher, but probably not. The statistician told me, he said, if you get 50 to 100, it's not going to change. The numbers won't change. And I thought, that can't be true. But you know what? He's been right, because now the numbers that are coming in, they're just remaining consistent within 2 or 3 percentages. Now, for you mathematicians, I mean, I'm pretty good with math, but I didn't realize there wouldn't be so much that there wouldn't be a variation. So we can see that 40% older than 3 years of age that came through our ministry, one of the causalities which we have known for same-sex attraction, homosexuality, was sexual abuse. 27.28% were sexually abused 3 to 10 times. And that's certainly my story. For those in a snapshot, I was sexually abused at 6, at 10, at 12, different people, different situations. But by the time I was a teenager, I was so messed up in my sexuality and my identity and gender. The only thing I thought I had to surrender to homosexuality, because I was so attracted to my same sex. And at the same time, even though I had pursued relationships with females, I was still so broken and so messed up internally. And plus, they were all calling me sissy queer faggot, so they had to be right. Right? Wrong. But that was my experience. And that's a lot of the experience. We didn't track abuse, verbal abuse, but we did track that. 50% of the respondents were sexually abused. 40% older than 3 years of age. 27.28, more than 3 times. 19 to 27% were sexually abused more than 6. So, do you currently have same-sex attractions? 59% said they do. 38.64% said that they don't. I was surprised that that number was a little higher than what I thought it would be, but it is what it is. If you do have same-sex attractions, do you currently consider yourself gay or homosexual? 15% said they do. But look at that number. After having been involved in our ministry, 60% say no. That's terrific, folks. That's a far cry from 99.9% don't change. Anybody heard that number thrown around? Every day in the gay media, they are quoting somebody who says that this isn't true. This is true, folks. And if it's true here, it's true in other ministries and churches as well. The gospel of Jesus Christ changes people's lives. The numbers are coming in. Do you see how thrilling this is? It's thrilling to me. I can't wait to get to the end of this project, but you better pray for me, because, man, there's a whole lot more work on the other side of this. There really is. This is just a snapshot. But just seeing this snapshot, it was like, I told Ann about it, and she goes, oh, you need to present that. This is thrilling. So do you believe it is acceptable to God for you to behave in homosexual acts? 90, the number was 86%, But do you know that 93% of those who were with us for at least a year said no? Do you understand what that means? That means that 93% that were involved in our ministry for at least a year came away embracing a biblical orthodox worldview on their sexuality. Is that effective? That's effective, folks. Is that, that's just so thrilling when we've been hearing that 99.9% people don't change. It's not true. People change all the time if they want. We've been saying that, we just didn't have any data. Now at least this one ministry has some hard data. Did FSM, did First Stone Ministries help you in overcoming any form of sexual sin and brokenness? 75% said yes. It's a thrilling number. When the gays are saying, you know, I remember being on an interview years ago, and this gay activist from the HRC in Washington, D.C. said, they're doing, you're a snake oil salesman because nobody than 33% ever change. And at that time, I said, you know what? I'll take 33% because Jesus' statistics is 25. Parable the sermon, parable the sower of the seed. Do you realize that, folks? His statistics, 25. And I will surely take 75%. Would you consider yourself a Christian maturing in obedience and faith? Having been involved with us for at least a year, 95.35% said yes. When I saw these numbers, I was just, honestly, folks, I didn't know they would be this high. I thought if we got 50%, we'd be doing great. Look at this. These are people that are anonymously answering this survey. Would you consider yourself free from sexual addiction or sexual sin as a result of being involved with First Stone Ministries? Now, as we know, sexual addiction and sexual brokenness is a hard thing to break free. 44.9% said yes, 41, so there was about, you know, this 85%, 86% that were coming that were really struggling, and 41% said no. Well, that doesn't surprise me. With 70% of the men in the church, last statistic, are looking at porn weekly. I think we're doing a pretty good job if we've got 44.1% that are finding freedom and lasting freedom. If your answer to question 25 is no, please select the best answer. And 40% had all these other different reasons, and I'm not going to belabor it, but it just reveals that this is a complicated issue. And people are indeed finding some freedom and actually projecting to find even more freedom. Excuse me. So before they came to First Stone, 20.93% said they were free or wasn't applicable to them. That's a low number. It says 60% were addicted. 18% had some progress. But look at the next thing. After they left First Stone, 60.46 free or mostly free. The gospel, living waters, intensive discipleship, pastoral care works. So that's a little snapshot about the survey. The survey will have so much more information. I wanted to present that to you, for folks, to give you hope. This is the 2016 Hope Conference of RHN, and I want you to remember that you saw hard data today that's coming in from people taking an anonymous survey. We're not manipulating this. Matter of fact, we'll turn it over to other people after we get done with this, and they can have the actual hard data, and it won't change. Matter of fact, they're going to read. I've got the first initial thing. It's huge, and let me tell you, folks, the comments in here, the things, the testimonies of the people are in black and white here. And when I was reading through some of these, I couldn't believe what they were saying, some of the things that Jesus had done for them. Hundreds of testimonies will come out of this. So why do these people go back, and why is there a war? Just from my experience, from my own life, from my brokenness, I just wanted to share a little bit about that today. So to begin with, the vision and goals are different, honestly. When I've ministered to people and I've heard people in all the war with the whole Exodus debacle and implosion and the arguments around it, when we look at the differences between the ex-gay or the ex-ex or the person that says it doesn't work, there are some significant differences. There's significant differences behind what is inside. There's also some handouts. Did everybody get a handout? Okay, because there's some blank spots for those of you who are kinesthetic and would like to fill in the blanks. Who has the handouts? Who needs a handout? Oh, okay, would you give those people those handouts? So we'll start there, please. Pardon me? Oh, we're out of them. Okay, I'm so sorry. If you email me and would like that, I will get that to you. Stephen@firststone.org. Anyhow, you can answer with me on the screen. How about that? So truly, the ex-gay, or what is called the overcomer. I don't even like the term ex-gay, but it's a soundbite that describes people who have come out of homosexuality. It is something that the world understands, but it's not a label that any of us should take, actually. Matter of fact, the subtitle of what I'm kind of proposing for my book is going to be, the reality of thousands of ex-gays living a victorious Christian life without any label. So overcomers embrace a process. Matter of fact, three things when people come to our ministry, I ask them when I sit down with them with a family or a struggler. They also have some intense paperwork. Nobody comes into our ministry easily. They actually have to be scrutinized because of some things that have happened in our history. There's legal forms and things they have to fill out. But the first thing is they have to want it themselves. The second is they need to be there to want to gain understanding. And the third thing is they have to embrace a process. And the person who actually overcomes knows that they're embracing a process. It's called sanctification in Christianity. The ex-gay, the overcomer, conforms to the image of Jesus Christ. They formulate an intimate relationship with God. They embrace a lifetime process of sanctification. Wouldn't we say that about all Christians? All Christians are on a journey and a walk of, hopefully we're being conformed more and more into the image of Jesus, right? Well, why wouldn't we expect any less than somebody who is dealing with one of life's most complicated things? Homosexuality and sexual addiction is extremely complicated and difficult to overcome. So people are in a process. Here's something that absolutely is not attractive to the world. And that is that God shows himself powerful with the weak. Who receives God's grace? Just leave that there for a second. We'll get back to it. The ex-gay, the overcomer, knows there is a suffering process, a process by which there's going to be pain in the offering. Now, so let's look at some of the differences of what's called the ex-exer, or the person that's apostate. They're falling away. They come to the ministry and they demand change. They demand on their terms, change me, God. And if you don't change me, then I'm done. I can't tell you how many people, they say, well, if God's all powerful and all willing, matter of fact, the very people that we've seen that used to be leaders, this is one of their behind the scenes demands. And when it didn't follow through the way they thought it should, orientation change or internal vices didn't change, and there's actually some reasons for that from most of the people that I've ministered to. The goal is always towards fixing the desire and the appetite when they come and they decide, I'm not doing this anymore. The goal was wrong to begin with. If that can change, and that's how we have to help people to understand the gospel, it's not that it's initially really a bad thing. I mean, who doesn't want change, right? In some regard to the appetites and desires. But if that's the only goal, it's the wrong goal. Jesus isn't enough. Jesus isn't the pearl of great price for these people. This has been my experience. They want deliverance from any suffering. Sorry, folks. You know what? The gospel actually promises suffering. Matter of fact, 1 Peter 4:1 promises that if you want to be free from sin, you must suffer in your flesh. It isn't a quick enough. It's not healing or freedom that's fast enough. Grace isn't true empowerment of faith for them. It's painful. And they give up. They don't go through the process of suffering. Therefore, since Christ suffered, and you know, it's entering in Philippians, Paul's letter to the Philippians, it's an actual integrating a place of relationship with Jesus. Relationship with Jesus is understanding what Andy did such a good job this morning of painting the picture of the crucified one who suffered so greatly. On the night of my salvation, when those people, these little crazy Christians in a little trailer park in Tacoma, Oklahoma, Assembly of God folks, and I thought they were absolutely over the top crazy. And as they were praying for me, this Catholic boy saw the crucified Christ coming alive on the cross and the heartbeat of God beating away forgiveness in the suffering of the sacrifice of Jesus. And when I believed and all the sin come up and out of me and into him, I said, I will follow. And that's how it began. And then when I entered into that place of saying, I will follow, I went home and I got the big Douay version of the Catholic Bible, one of those big, beautiful family table Bibles from the Vatican. And I blew the dust off in it and lugged it down into my room and I prayed over it. And folks, I tell you what, as I prayed over that, I said, Jesus, I don't even know. The priest over here, my parents' parish priest, was telling me, of course God's made you gay. He loves you just the way you are. Wink, wink, it's all the more reason to come to Mass. It's like, well, that's weird. And as I prayed over the Bible, and I flipped it open right there. I did not even know where to look. And I flipped open. And in, you know, a lot of Bibles, there's a little label above a passage of Scripture. And this says, laws on sexual immorality. I thought, well, you know, homosexuality just might be in that list. And my eyes fell right down. And there it was. Why didn't anyone tell me it was there? Leviticus 18:21. Man shall not lie with another man as he does with a woman. It's an abomination. And that set my feet, my knees, to bend down and say, I don't know how to change Jesus, but if you'll change me, I'll follow. And if you don't change me, I'm still going to agree with your word. And do you know that he has been so faithful? And in the early days, it was rough. oh man, you this sex addict and what I dealt with in my mind. And it was rough. But as I yielded and I learned to be a part in the body of Christ and took to heart the word of God that transformed my, one of my life verses is Psalms 107, verse 20. It says, and he sends his word to them to deliver them from their destructions. So the Lord sent his law to me, not to make me safe through the law, but that through the law that this simple man could become wise and believing for more. And isn't that what this is all about for all of us? They don't like suffering. Therefore, since Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. This is the same thinking you have to have as an overcomer. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for what? For the will of God. That's an awesome study right there. Just that little phrase. Just do a little word search on the will of God. So let's look at foundations. These are some foundations that I know that nobody's really going to walk in freedom from my experience in ministry unless they have these firm foundations. So how do you receive anything from God? How do you get saved? It's a real simple thing. It's the anchor of a foundation. If you don't have faith to believe, you will not succeed. You know, faith's a very ambiguous thing. It doesn't have handles on it. But faith is a substance. It has a substance of things hoped for. And there is an evidence. There is an evidence that the things hoped for and the evidence that comes about as you continue to believe and you continue to believe and change does happen. The idea of being, you know, Jesus has done such a work in my life. That's why it was so painful to watch what was happening with so many people falling back. And I'm going, these people have not believed to the end. That's what the Lord says, right? To the end we have to believe. What is faith? It's an evidence of things not seen. You have to continue to believe. Has anyone seen Jesus physically? With the robes, with the nails in this room. If you have, you are rare. We must believe without seeing. And yet, he's so gracious that as we continue this process of yielding and believing, he changes us. And you know what? It is actually impossible. The word please there, it's an emotional word. Do you know that you make God happy? It just means to make God happy. To make him feel good. You want to make God feel good? Do you love the Lord? Believe him. Even if nothing changes, not one feeling makes him happy. And there's a lot of people not making him very happy. And then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's why the word of God, I was so grateful that I got to be a part of a revival movement within the Southern Baptist Church with the fullness, it was called the Fullness Movement, and the Vineyard Church, and all these people were just, we were seeing miracles and things, and it was so important. The foundation of the word of God was so transformative in my life. I was so crazy. I'm not even telling myself, this was really bizarre. I was so in love with God. I literally, because of what happened to me, I would literally take scripture and tape it to my chest. Please help me. I put scriptures above my bed. And the next door neighbors told my parents, I think you need to have him admitted. He has really gone off the rocker. When I broke up all my, there used to be these things that we had. They're giant CDs. They're called vinyls. And I busted them all up, threw them in the garbage. And they're going, he really needs to be admitted. His word just changed my life. And I know that when the word of God gets into people, and it's engrafted in them, it will set them free. You know, Jesus asked an interesting question about his second coming. Folks, I think in John's epistle, he said, you know, we're in the last hour. Folks, well, I think we're in the last seconds. And Jesus said something interesting about his coming in the last day. Does anyone know what that question was? Will I find what on earth? Do you see, there's such a war against the idea of believing in something that is unseen but yet real. All nature proclaims, and even in this day, the technology, the ability that we have to see in outer space and microspace, DNA screams there is a creator. It screams it. The Hubble telescope images scream there is a creator. And there is such a war of deception, of strongholds in our minds to attack this. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go by in it, because difficult is that gate. And there are how many? If these stats are real and this is coming out, I'm like going, wow, this is so much greater than 25%. Then Anne, the other night, we were talking about it, and she goes, but you remember the ones that were closest to him, the percentage is 91-something percent, because one of them was a devil, but the other 11 followed him to death. So when I think about that 25%, and we're doing so much better in almost all the ministries I'm aware of, this is a pretty good work, folks. It's a beautiful work. Okay, that slide was in there twice. Another firm foundation, the Word of God. I've already been speaking on this, but the Word of God for the gay Christian, or for the one that wants to believe in their appetites over the Word, has to be discredited. So what's the greatest enemy of the Christian life, according to Hebrews? Our greatest enemy, and which is really the root of all sin, is what? Unbelief. It's the opposite of faith. And this is simple stuff, but it's actually the foundation that every one of us are under attack. Constant unbelief, doubt, fear, constantly coming against the mind of those who would say, I will believe in Jesus. Therefore, laying aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receiving with meekness the implanted Word of God, which is able to save your soul. That Word is delivering, setting free, making free your mind. A lot of times, I'm amazed that people don't realize that they need to talk about their internal world of thinking, and they don't even understand that they're dealing with something that is not of them. That they need something that sets their soul free from an entity, a thing that has gotten a hold of them. And the Word of God says, it will set you free if you will allow His voice, His ways, His words to permeate you. You know, there's a famine coming. Amos 8:11 says, and there's a famine for what? Hearing the Word of God. I'm telling you, I'm amazed. I'll go into some churches and they'll quote maybe one or two scriptures. I am so grateful. I have a pastor. Every Sunday, the screen is full of scripture after scripture after scripture. And there's a washing that happens. And there should be a washing in each of us every day. And you know, some of my past associates, I do a little bit of inventory about all of these things that I'm presenting, and they're null and void in many ways. See it in. This was heartbreaking. CBN. These statistics that were released just a few years ago. they did a poll on all these churches of the youth groups for those that were 16 to 25. Listen to what they believe. Well, first, what they did not believe. They could not name the four Gospels. They did not know what the Ten Commandments were. They could not state the first book of the Bible or the last book of the Bible. They communicated salvation in Christ through faith and his substitutionary death on the cross by faith, that they didn't believe in it. They didn't think it was necessary. And they didn't think that it was necessary to live a lifestyle of repentance and obedience to God by faith. They did not believe that you were saved by grace through faith. They did not believe in the sinless life of Jesus, and they did not believe in the virgin birth. But guess what they did believe in? Believed in UFOs and aliens. And guess what else they believed in? They believed it was okay for people to get married homosexually. This was a few years ago. The stats are probably worse. So what is the beginning of a walk of faith in God? What is the beginning of wisdom? What is the foundation that must be? I'm going to tell you an experience. I'll watch the people that come through my office and the people I've mentored that have gone to do ministry and gone on to really be successful, and there's many of them, and this is a firm foundation they always have. And the ones that don't, the ones that fall away, they don't have this, and they make excuses for it. Matter of fact, there's such an assault on the holiness of God in this day and the fear of the Lord, and it's just ruining and wrecking the wisdom that God has for us in the church. And look how many verses. I mean, if the Bible says something a couple of times, it should be taken great note of. You should really hone in on it. But when it says it 19 times or 20 times, I think he's trying to get our attention. Another thing is I've known consistently that those who walk in freedom have godly accountability. Those who don't succeed don't have it consistently. It's so important that we confess our sins one to another and pray for one another. I was talking last night. I was so blessed by so many conversations last night, and I was talking with a family last night, and a husband and wife, and just this whole idea in the church that one of the things that's so hard to even talk about is the idea of the shame that's around sexual sin. And it's still, even in this day, so prevalent in the church at large. We should be taught, if it is the biggest concern of the day, when we've got gay flags flying up everywhere, and the first transsexual flag flying up over City Hall of St. Louis, was in St. Louis on our way here, and on the news, they're raising the transsexual flag over City Hall of St. Louis, the gay flag over Parliament in Canada, and the Prime Minister actually said this: we are raising the flag of pride over the nation of Canada. Didn't say gay or anything like that. The representation that we are raising pride over a nation. That is some of the most fearful words that I've heard confessed over a nation. We should be talking about sexual sin and our sins. We should be cultivating an atmosphere in the church where it is something that is the norm. But guess who it's going to start with? It's got to start with us. And it starts with this. It just starts with, Jesus, help me. If you'll do it, we can make a difference. Confess your sins one to another. Pray for one another. And you know, the mark of humility is to confess the thing inside of you that's wearing you down. Not even the thing that you've sinned in. Don't wait till you've sinned. Confess it beforehand. He who covers his sins will not prosper. whoever confesses and forsakes them. Mercy, mercy, mercy. So it's not just confession session is what I tell people. And then in the end of this, I talk about an acronym I've come up with over the years called ABS. Accountability, boundary, and a spiritually devoted life. But in accountability, it's actually holy living with others relationally in such a way that it becomes a natural flow of your relationships within the body of Christ with safe people that you walk out life with, where you don't have to labor to get through all the shame and the darkness to finally confess the thing that's eating at you. And every one of us, especially those of you who are leaders, are to set the example of this. And you know what? When I was in cowboy church, and it really is cowboy church, it's in the shape of a teepee when I got saved. It's goth architecture. You can look it up. And I was in cowboy church, and the Lord said, you do it. And you know what? There were men in that church, I guarantee you, and I knew some of them, they're looking at me like, oh, great, we've got the little queer here in our church. That's okay, because that's their brokenness. You know, if Jesus wants to call you up in maturity, if you're going to make a difference in this day, you got to get beyond that. So what? What are they going to think? We're going to be pleasers of men or God? And when we do this, we start enjoying life together in this thing called Christianity. Repairing right relationships in the mentorship. This is such a painful place. But there's this ongoing thing that I learned really early on in my walk. I didn't realize how much I hated my dad. I had so many bitter root judgments against him. Until I started an inner healing, discipleship, counseling, and just processing my thoughts and feelings of where I'd landed with all this homosexuality and sexual addiction. And it was like, oh, Malachi 4:6, the last verse in the Old Testament, which says, turning the hearts of the fathers to the children. Well, my dad was the Navy boxer. And when I got beat up as a 13-year-old and came home with two black eyes, when they said, sissy queer faggot, you black faggot, and beat me up, my dad says, well, I hope they look worse than you do. There's no comforting. But in the healing process for me, it was imperative that I forgive him from my heart. And in the result of learning to suffer and die in my flesh, I got to turn my dad's heart towards me. And when he was dying of cancer, who did he call to shave him and shave the hair off his head? Who did he call to come comfort him? Not my older brother. Repairing these right relationships with same sex. I was somewhere, I don't even remember, I think it was in D.C. at the PFOX thing, and I was just sitting there, and all of a sudden, I was just like, this whole thing is really just about becoming mature. It's just real simple. Grow up. Grow up to be gendered male beings created in the image of God, and grow up to be women of God. I know that may sound a little black and white and hard, I'm kind of packaged that way, but really, ultimately, it's about just becoming mature, right? Sanctification. And we really need to learn how to walk in relationship. Men with men, women with women. And this is developed in the church. And these are things that are not developed. You know, I was hanging out with a lot of these people that have fallen back, you know, and I'd always be struck by, man, did the men in their church let them get away with this? Like, you guys talk like you guys are still gay and in the lifestyle. And they're always talking about, you know, the devil wears Prada. It's like, wow, that's kind of weird. It's like, I wonder if everybody knew that you guys talk like this out there. And it wasn't consistency. Well, no wonder they fell away. There are reasons why people fall away, folks. They didn't believe. And they were not operating internally with their own internal sanctification. It should not surprise us that the Word of God is true, forever settled in heaven, right? So there's a couple of books that we recommend on specifically this idea. growth into manhood. There's a couple of things in there. You know, I don't always agree with everything that somebody says, but it's a really good book. And then Anne's book on restoring sexual identity. Wasn't that a beautiful testimony today? That lady, Karen, is Karen. I mean, you know, and just and Anne's going, oh wow. I know Anne. She's like, wow, that is so awesome, and humbled, and how beautiful. That's something that we could write that would help somebody else. That family I was talking to last night, they were going on and on about that little red pen drive. They took it home and they were crying and talking about the videos on it. And Andrew Franklin, who came through our ministry, and I'm just sitting there and I'm like shaking and I'm thinking, thank you, Lord. People that don't find lasting freedom, they don't complete an inner healing process. That's why I love Living Waters. I've been doing Living Waters for 25 years. And I still do the national trainings. And you know what? I'm going to be doing one in January or in July. And you know, every time I go to one, I see amazing things. And I was raised Catholic. And the last training last year, they gave me three Catholic priests. Well, one was a Catholic priest. One was a Catholic that had lived in a monastery, but he had left. And then it was a Catholic deacon from another country. And then I had an evangelical leader of a church network. And it was like when I pulled out my packet, I'm going, oh, wow, this is going to be a little rough. But you know, folks, it was one of the most amazing groups I ever had. And just unfolding things with people who were willing, once they put off the cap, being a minister or a priest or a deacon, saying, you know what, we're all going to be just boys, men, but having humble hearts like children before the Father in heaven, and we're going to humble ourselves, and we're going to deal with their internal life. That's what Living Waters does, and it provides a healing pool. Now, I had inner healing through other ministries as well, inner healing and deliverance. And I was amazed at what happened through that process in my freedom. And a lot of times, you know, it's even in this line of work, people, they won't deal with spiritual warfare. They don't even know they're dealing with spiritual warfare. There's such a need to complete this. And I've had, you know, some people even in our line of work say, reparative therapy and talk therapy and all that stuff. You guys do that weird thing, inner healing. Well, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jesus to do what? What does it say? To bind up and to heal the broken of heart. That's what the Spirit of the Lord wants to do in us. Many times I will just be praying, and sometimes we want to just pray real quick and move on. We have to sometimes just pray and be present to the Holy Spirit. And it's amazing what happens. Of course there can be transformation and the realignment of your will and the realignment of your thinking and the realignment of your desires. The idea of being a gay man or homosexually inclined is so far removed from me. And some people say, I don't believe you. I don't really care. I'm telling you the truth before Jesus Christ. That's been removed for decades. Now, yes, I can find certain men attractive. So what? I can find a lot of women attractive too. I'm not going to lust after them. Because of inner healing, realignment of my will, the cross. Again, this is one thing I've so enjoyed, of kind of a renewal in my life several years ago, even before, you know, the Catholic stream with Desert Dreams, you know, and the controversy around some of that. And by the way, folks, that's not why I wear a cross. I wear this cross. I've not taken it off since my daughter died on the day I took a national stand with the Exodus. The day I took a national stand, she went into the hospital. And this cross represents momentary light afflictions. And let me tell you, I'm not making little of that affliction, because it was the most painful thing I've ever gone through. But this is a daily reminder that to have fellowship with me, we are going to walk a walk of suffering, and it is a cross, the cross of Jesus Christ, that prevails over our lives, that gives us freedom to walk in righteousness and healing. And this is something that the people that are going back into homosexuality do not understand. That's why I love the meditations of the Passion and the sufferings of our Lord. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. And let me tell you, folks, it's not just a one-time deal. It is salvation to those, and the power of God to those who believe daily. It really is transformative. The prayer life, I talk to people all the time. They think, I remember being a baby Christian and going, wow, how could anyone ever pray for an hour? And then the Lord's Prayer. It was like, well, we pray the Lord's Prayer all the time. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. You know, this prayer, the warrior prayer. Say it with me. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil or the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. But if you take this prayer and you break it down and you just spend a little bit of time on every little phrase, our Father who art in heaven, holy, holy, awesome Father, you're my Father. And you start praying and thinking about him just being a father. You can spend 5 minutes there. And before you know it, if you take the next part, oh, your kingdom come, you know, like it is in heaven, and you start praying that down, it's easy to pray an hour. I pray this every day. I pray these literal words when I wake up, when I get up, when I go to sleep, when in my process of praying through the day, I praise the phraseology of this. And I also continue to pray lots of other prayers. And yes, I'm a little wild. I pray in the Spirit. I pray every way I can pray. And I know it's kept me sane. People ask me, how do you really find freedom, Stephen? These are just some little things that I have found and what I minister to those who come. And the reality of spiritual warfare, let me tell you, folks, it's amazing how many people do not simply believe Ephesians 6:12. They just do not believe this one verse in the Bible. And this is in the Living Bible. It's a paraphrase. But I think it's important that if you knew that there were people coming to your front porch who had guns and chains and whips, and they were coming to your front porch, Brett, what would you do? Grab my gun. Yes, especially in Oklahoma, we got our shotguns. What would you do? I hope you would at least go 911, right? And take authority. But a lot of Christians don't. And when you're being bashed up right here in your brain, and the little voices and imagery and oppression, who's that from? And we wonder why people can't find freedom. They're not practicing spiritual warfare. And they're weary because why? They're prayerless. We're not to be unaware of the demonic subterfuge and assignments against us, which is to continue with a bitter root. I have never met anyone who deals with homosexuality or any form of sexual addiction that does not deal with some bitter root of unforgiveness and criticalness. I've never met that person. Every person I've ever met has this problem. And it's a scheme to keep people in bondage. The spirit of condemnation, this is a whole nother thing about dealing with shame and brokenness in people's lives that need prayer and rebuke. The thought life, keeping the thought life complete. You know, Linda, I think it was Linda, had put the verse up there in her workshop that we are to take every thought captive. And this little Catholic boy behind his drafting table in the engineering department, second week I was saved, called up the Southern Baptist preacher and said, I am so oppressed, I can't even draw. I could not even draw. I was so oppressed. And I didn't know what it was. And so we met at Casa Bonita. Anybody heard of Casa Bonita, where you used to raise the flags up and get all the tacos you wanted? Anyhow, we met there at this restaurant. And he said, well, we've been studying the Bible. And he said, just name it. And I said, what? He said, yeah, just name it. And I said, like, name homosexuality? And he said, yeah. And he said, name it. And then when you name it, take authority over it in the name of Jesus. I thought, man, these people are weird. But you know, I went home that night and I prayed. And I literally felt something jerk out of my back. You can do whatever you want with that. It worked. And I got a whole lot more freedom. So in conclusion, we know that this whole thing is a walk of faith. It is by faith. And faith is the substance of things hoped for. And we know in these verses that it's impossible to please God without it. It's actually a fight. Doesn't it say a fight here? A fight of faith? To lay hold of what? It's a fight of faith to lay hold of eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord, which you were called. So faith, remaining, and if you continue is what Colossians chapter 1 says. It is continuing to remain. Perseverance of the saints. Those are the ones who are going to be clothed in white raiment, if you read Revelation. And we overcome by faith in Jesus and by faith in his word. And I'm going to tell you what, without this, you don't receive grace. Humility is the prerequisite for the power of God. Grace gives you not just unmerited favor. It's transformative to take you to the next level where you can have power according to these verses. We have quite a bit of information on our website, maybe some out here, definitely on the pen drive on the issue of humility. Andrew Murray's book is a great book. The love of God, this is something that just absolutely broke my heart, this passage. I tell you in truth in Christ, I'm not lying, my conscience also bearing witness in the Holy Spirit, that I have great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. And I remember my best friend and associate pastor, when we opened up this little church years ago, I don't do that anymore, but during that time I was heavy-hearted over a lot of people that were falling away. And I quoted this verse, and he said, you know, I was focusing on the second part. Do you know we're supposed to have so much love that we should be accursed? That we could be accursed. Do you understand what that means? That you would have so much love inside of you that you would be willing to go to hell? How many people love like that? And he said, brother, why don't we focus on the first part of the verse? And I was like, wow, yeah. He said, who has unceasing, who has great sorrow and continued grief? Who has that? Usually a parent will. But if we could just cultivate that in the church, about all those people, I couldn't even, you know, everybody was posting stuff about Orlando. I couldn't even bear to post anything. Oh, those people are going through the suffering. We need to ask Jesus to cultivate that kind of love. I already talked about these things here. You gotta want it. You gotta have understanding, and you gotta process through faith in humility as a lifestyle, and consistently practice spiritual warfare. I don't know anybody that really walks in freedom without core strength. And this is a little acronym I've come up with. This is coming down to finality now, really, truly, in conclusion. Accountability and boundaries. You know what boundaries, if you think about boundaries and you have the word restriction in your mind, you're already setting yourself up for failure. But if you look at boundaries as safety, then you'll walk in freedom. And the spiritually devoted life. So let me just pray for you. Thank you for giving me your attention. What's your name? Carol has evaluation forms, if you would take one of those and fill those out. But let me pray for you. Father, thank you for, again, the wonderful opportunity to sow hope. Thank you for the stats that are coming out that, in fact, just confirms what we should have already believed to begin with, and that is your word is transformative. But I do thank you, Lord, that people are rising up, that they're telling the truth, and I pray in Jesus' name that there would be a deposit of hope, that there is a way, even a deeper way, of walking in freedom for all of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.